what is your, your view of that use of force during that time period?
Totally unnecessary.
What do you mean?
Well, first of all, pulling him down to the ground face down and putting your knee on the neck for that amount of time is just uncalled for. I saw no reason why the officers felt they were in danger, if that's what they felt. And that's what they would have to feel to be able to use that kind of force.
Have you ever, in all the years you've been working for the Minneapolis Police Department, been trained to kneel on the neck of someone who is handcuffed behind their back in a prone position?
No, I haven't.
Is that, if that were done, would that be considered force?
Absolutely.
What level of force might that be?
That would be the top tier, the deadly force.
Why?
Because of the fact that if your knee is on a person's neck, that can kill them.
And you were a patrol officer from 1985 to approximately 1993 when you took the sergeant's exam and were promoted.
Yes.
And so it's fair to say that since 1993, so 27, 28 years, you've not been on patrol in the city of Minneapolis.
Correct.
You're not out patrolling the streets, making arrests, things of that nature.
No.
All right. And it's fair to say then that your experience with the use of force of late has been primarily through training.
Through what?
Your training.
Yes.
All right. Meaning you're not out actively, other than perhaps arresting a homicide suspect, you're not out actively patrolling and arresting people for less serious offenses.
No.
I'm presuming that since 1985 until the present day, tactics have changed as a police officer.
Some tactics have changed, yes.
Right.
Laura Coates, back to your takeaway, listening to the repeated testimony, the very calm and methodical testimony of Lieutenant Zimmerman.
Make no mistake about it, John, this was damning testimony. This blows out of the water the notion that Derek Chauvin was trained to do that which he did, that somehow it was part and parcel, baked into the recipe of every police training. Everyone knows that you do this. And remember, they were trying to distinguish between what bystanders who don't have police training, the MMA fighter, what he does or does not know, his training at the police academy. They distinguish between the off-duty Minneapolis firefighter who was trying to implore them to also allow her to render aid, distinguishing the EMT workers who were not trained as police officers. Then you go into the officers who were saying, actually, this is not how we're trained. And this particular lieutenant saying, since at least 1985, he has been repeatedly trained that you know that somebody who's in the prone position or handcuffed is going to have difficulty breathing, move them immediately. Also saying that once somebody is handcuffed, he clarified, the threat is essentially gone. Yeah, they may be able to kick you, but the use of deadly force is no longer needed here. And so you have all of these things. The only thing the defense was able to try to do was try to suggest and insinuate that because of his tenure, because he's a veteran police officer and a homicide detective and no longer a patrol beat cop, that somehow he was out of touch on the use of force. Somehow he has no idea what altercations look like nowadays. And if you think about it, John, how outlandish that is. Yes, officer training has changed since 1985. Yes, weapons have changed since 1985. But the human neck, the human knee, and our ability to respirate has not changed since at least 1985.
And Chief Ramsey, the importance of this for the prosecution is you're trying to win over the jury, and you can't lose jurors on this question. Was Officer Chauvin acting, in his view, in a reasonable way with this use of force, or was this just beyond the pale? The prosecution saying 9 minutes and 29 seconds, no longer any resistance. What power did you put in the testimony of this veteran officer, again, repeatedly being asked and repeatedly saying, I just don't see it. This situation was under control, and we were well past the point where any force anywhere near what we were seeing could be necessary.
Well, he's a seasoned law enforcement veteran. I mean, he's the most senior person in the entire department. He's been on the job since 1981. He has spent a considerable amount of time in homicide, so he is very familiar with investigating situations in which people have lost their lives. I was just thinking when he said police training has changed. Well, yeah, it's changed. I mean, I went through the police academy 50 years ago, 1971, as a rookie police officer, and even then, we were not trained to put our knee on somebody's neck for 9 minutes. I mean, if anything, training and police policy and procedure has gotten more restrictive in terms of use of force. The training is light years better than it used to be. I mean, if anything, the needle has moved in a positive direction, not a negative direction. And the actions of Chauvin are just unjustifiable, even when the defense is raising all these, you know, hypotheticals. What if this, what if that? It has nothing to do with what actually took place on May 25th of last year. Absolutely nothing. This case has to stand on its own. And his use of force in that situation has to stand on its own based on the facts and circumstances of that case. Not the what if, woulda, coulda, shoulda, what took place that day, and why did he use the level of force that he used for that sustained period of time? Is that consistent with policy and training? The answer to that is no.
And so, Laura Coates, we are now at the end of the first week of testimony, 5 days of trial testimony, 17 days if you go back to some of the pretrial hearings and the selection of the jury and all that, but 5 days now for these jurors who go home for the weekend. I want to walk through some of what played out during the week, but I want to start with this, especially as we watched Lieutenant Zimmerman finish his testimony, then the cross-examination, and then the redirect from the prosecutor. One of the challenges for a prosecutor, you can plan everything the night before, you can work with your witness the night before, but then you have to react, you have to be nimble and react to what you saw and you mentioned. The defense attorney, Eric Nelson, he's doing the best he can there with the material he has, trying to say to your point, well, you've been on the desk for a long time. You're not in a patrol car. You're not a guy jumping out of a patrol car in these tense situations. It's been a long time since you've been on the street, you know, in the rough and tumble, if you will. And so then the prosecutor has to get back up, as Mr. Frank did, then walking through, well, let's go through this again. Just your sense, your grading of the prosecution and their nimbleness in reacting.
I think they were great at being nimble at this because, of course, they're not only up against trying to have the explanation to laymen about what is actually a common sense issue. They don't have to prove things that the average person would not be able to understand. The average person has a neck and a knee and understands the constriction of breathing. The average person would be able to understand what you would not advise your own child to do in rough play or otherwise. And so he's really trying to point out methodically, and I understand the constraints of the defense. And again, John, we have yet to see the defense case or the battle of the experts on that substantial causal factor of death and the autopsy medical examiner. But so far, the prosecutors are buttressed in their ability to understand common sense and what jurors are thinking here. You've got this idea, what I thought was very striking, was that every single law enforcement officer that we've seen so far, normally we hear about this sort of blue code of silence and trying to protect one of their own. You saw a distancing of a 10-foot pole away from Derek Chauvin, not trying to filter their testimony through the filter of, hey, look, he's one of us, I can understand what he did. No, they were quite forthright and resolute about this officer being rogue in a sense. So I think that's very powerful. And going into a weekend, time is going to be the best friend of the prosecution because all these questions that have not been answered as to what would it have taken to have taken his pulse, to take your knee off him, what would it have taken to do those things, that's lingering in the juror's mind for Friday, for Saturday, for Sunday, into Monday, and we have no indication that the defense case is going to happen next week. This is going to stew and fester and not to the benefit of Derek Chauvin.
And Chief, to that point, you're watching as an expert, somebody, as you just mentioned, 5 decades of experience in law enforcement. You're also watching as a human being as this plays out. To Laura's point, the prosecution hopes that it won the first week. It knows this is a long journey. It knows the defense, you know, the prosecution controls the pace and the witness list right now. The defense will get that choice. But just from watching throughout the week yourself, if you were a juror, are you going home with questions? The prosecution left me wondering this. Or are you going home thinking, so far, these guys have made a compelling case?
Well, the prosecution has made a compelling case, and the defense is fortunate that it's not wrapping up today, that there's still more to come, because quite frankly, they don't really have a leg to stand on right now, in my opinion. I do think it's going to come down to the more expert witnesses, especially the autopsy report, medical examiner, you know, what was the cause of death? Was the actions of Chauvin a substantial contributing factor to his cause of death? You know, once you go through the whole thing about his enlarged heart and drugs and so forth, you know, and that's going to be critical. And who wins that battle? And that's going to decide this case, in my opinion, because I think clearly, as far as what we've seen so far and what we've heard so far, this isn't something that they're going to be able to say at the end of the day that was consistent with his training and with policy of the Minneapolis Police Department. They've lost that one. They can only hope now that when the expert witnesses come forward, and they will find somebody to testify more in their favor in terms of that medical examiner's report. I think everything's going to wind up hinging on that.